Claudio, this is wonderful. I love the art on the wall. I love the restaurant. I love your wife. She's fabulous. And, you know, we're going to have a great experience. So let's sit down.
Thank you.
Welcome to Lizzie Restaurant. It's Northern Italian cuisine, and I'm sitting here with Claudio Bernardo, and he is the proprietor, and I'm so excited to meet you, and you invited me for this wonderful food and to watch your chef prepare some. You know, the food is very simple and it's quick, so the people, when they come here for dinner, they can have their food fast. They don't have to wait forever, and that's the best part, and it's fresh.
Yes, it is, and thank you for being here. And we can see a couple of dishes that the chef was able to prepare.
In minutes?
Few minutes on each, and fegato alla veneziana and octopus.
Oh yeah, I am so excited. I'm here at Lizzie Restaurant, and it's Northern Italian cuisine, and I'm with Javier Ferrer, and he is going to prepare some octopus. Love octopus.
Put a little oil, so put in the grill. Potatoes, big hot.
How long do you cook the octopus?
The octopus we cook for an hour.
1 hour?
Yeah, 1 hour in the oven, like base octopus, hour.
So do you boil it first? Or?
Yeah, we boil it first with white and onion and tomatoes.
That sounds delicious.
Yeah, for 1 hour.
1 hour, yes. Wow. And do you beat it at all, you know, like to make it tender?
No, we keep it in the oven for 1 hour after it's very tender.
And it happens by itself?
Yeah,
because I heard about people doing the washing machine. They put it in the washing machine and they made it, beat it, the old-fashioned way.
No.
Oh.
After we grill and we cut it, slices ready to eat.
Very tender.
Yeah, very tender.
And delicious.
Yeah, and delicious.
And the white potatoes, how long do they take to cook?
The potatoes, we cook for 45 minutes in the oven with the onions, salt, pepper, and extra virgin olive oil.
Ah,
yes.
That makes it so refreshing.
Yes.
Do you serve it with olive oil as well?
No, salad.
Nice.
Yes.
So that's a complete meal, in other words.
Yeah.
Olive oil, is it from Italy?
Yes.
And so when you plate this, it's a very pretty picture, because you have the sliced octopus and the potatoes. So the potatoes, is that equivalent to like a half a potato?
Yes.
Oh. And one of the great things you have to have is a great knife when you're slicing this.
Yeah.
I think it's so important when you're plating a dish that it's very attractive.
Very little. Mustard dressing.
What is that again?
This is the sauce for this, extra virgin olive oil, mustard, salt, and pepper.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yes.
Javier, do you put the octopus in a washing machine and make it tender?
No.
What do you do with it?
We cook in the oven for 1 hour to be tender. And the octopus, when you cook in the oven, do you cover with the top? Then in 45 minutes or hour, it's very tender.
So it steams, in other words?
It's similar, like steam, it's braised.
Oh, wonderful. Because
yes.
I've also seen people beat the octopus on the shore, you know, on the.
I don't know what it does, but it's, for me, it's only to keep in the oven for an hour, it's perfect.
Yeah.
It's nothing. To
very tender.
Yeah, very tender.
That's very important.
Yes, yeah. That's important.
I love it.
Yeah.
And I love the way you plate the dish. It's
Thank
really
you.
Beautiful.
Thank you very much.
You know, it looks appetizing. It looks like spring. The octopus, is it an appetizer or is it an entree?
No, this is appetizer. It's appetizer, yes.
It looks delicious.
Thank you.
Javier, what are you making next?
And now I'm making the cut liver, Venetian style.
Ah.
Yes.
And you saute this?
Yeah, I will saute.
And this is the main course?
That's the main course.
How fantastic. And you know, I haven't had calf's liver since I was a child, so this will be a new experience.
A pile of rice with curry. That's a curry.
What kind of rice is that?
Pile of rice. We make it's like a steamed rice. We saute with the onion. And we put it we put guar, salt, pepper, put it in the oven for 20 minutes.
Don't forget the butter.
Yes, put the butter now.
Right, and this goes in the oven to bake?
The bit of rice, we cook it in the oven for 20 minutes.
Oh, okay.
Yes, 20 minutes to be a little like dry, no motion.
It's not fried rice.
Similar like this, fried rice.
Oh, okay. The liver just takes a few minutes.
Yeah, a few minutes because it's very thin.
It's very thin?
Yeah.
Is that a lot of olive oil?
Over here we put, because we saute it this way, that way put a little bit more.
Oh.
Yes.
Because you wanted to cover the liver, is that right?
Exactly.
I see.
To have nice color.
Yeah.
Now we cook. And this is caramel onion, we put in the pan with sugar to make it brown color, and cherry vinegar.
And how long does that take to make?
To cook this, take like 10 minutes, no more than 10 minutes.
So everything is very quick, actually.
Yes, very, yes.
You got to keep
it
going.
To keep it very nice and hot.
Careful now. We don't want you to burn up. You know, what's really nice is the fact that all of these dishes are very quick.
Yes.
So you get it out to the customer in time.
Exactly.
And the customer's very happy.
Exactly.
That's fantastic. I might even try that at home. It looks so simple.
Yeah, now you have the color. We mix together.
Whoa.
Silvano, dame perejil. We will put a little parsley.
What was that, parsley?
Yes, chopped parsley.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
You know, Javier, I haven't had liver since I was a kid, but this looks so exciting. I think, you know, it's so simple. You make it look so simple that when I go home, I think I'm going to try this. It looks absolutely delicious. Jon Haggins' Globetrotter is like no other travel book in the world. When I think of travel, I think of friends from around the world. I've traveled to Malaysia, Thailand, India, everywhere. You're going to absolutely love the book and the recipes. You will whet your appetite with these incredible aromatic recipes. Remember, my world is your world. So get up, get out, and travel. You know, I haven't had liver since I was a child, so this is going to be a really new experience. And it was so simple that I thought I could go home and prepare this. You know, not that I cook a lot, but I mean, this is just so simple. And I think it's perfect when you have food like that, you know. The other thing is, where are you from in Italy?
I'm just outside Venice. Place is called Mestre. And parents, the aunts, they were from my grandma from Venice herself. Basically, like after the Second World War or during, my grandma used to make a uniform for military and trade it for flowers or first necessity. She was living in the island of Torcello in Venice. And liver was one of the poor cuts that was available as a meat.
Right.
Another one was a rabbit, for instance.
I was going to ask you about rabbits.
Yeah, that also is very in vogue in Venice, and once in a while we feature as a specials as well.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
So all these poor dishes basically is mostly a tradition of the Venetian cuisine.
Yeah, I think that's interesting. And rabbit, it's interesting how they catch them. They make these traps for them, and they go down and get the rabbit or whatever. And it's a common dish, rabbit.
Yes, yes.
I think it's fantastic. Every culture has its own specialties, I think.
Definitely.
You know, and that was something. It's not common here in the States, rabbit, but you can get it in some restaurants.
Yes, yeah, you could. Yeah, there are some specialty gourmet. Specialties, the delivery that they came.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you can get great goods. Yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely. Like getting duck or whatever.
Yes, the same yes, kind yes.
Of thing. Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's kind of wonderful. I think, you know, food is so international. And, you know, it's interesting. You can take a steak and you can make it Italian. You can take rabbit and make it Italian. You can do all these different things. It's how you prepare it with the olive oil, and you know, and your olive oil you obviously get from Italy.
Yes, we
do. And where in Italy do you get the olive oil?
The one that we use the most is from Tuscany.
Ah.
Yes, so it's an olive oil. We actually put a little label also of Lezia in the bottling, so it became a little more personalized.
How wonderful. Yeah.
Yeah, as well as we have a couple of wines, for instance, that we pick from California, like a Chardonnay and a Cabernet.
So just you have a mix. You have American wines, you have Italian
wines.
Yeah, I've
been a guest of this country for the past 30 years. We enjoy also, you know.
How fantastic. But I think, what about balsamic?
Balsamic, we had a we still have the extra vecchio, e vecchio,
right?
And about 25 years and old and from Modena.
Oh,
simply,
it's
beautiful,
amazing.
Typical bottles.
Yeah, it's amazing.
A drop can make a difference in your salad.
Oh yes. I was in one of the factories, or I should say, the purveyors that make the balsamic, and it was amazing. These little barrels, and the history behind it, amazing.
Yeah,
absolutely amazing.
From generation to generation.
Exactly. And the young man who was talking was like the great-great-grandson.
Imagine.
You know, it's an industry, and it's a family. You know what's interesting about Italy? Family. Family is so important. Where in America, you don't have families. The minute you turn 18, you move away.
Yes, that's right.
Maybe no more because everything is so expensive. Yeah. But that's where it was. But there you've got the family. You have generations living together. And that unity, you know, you've got the grandma who can watch the kids while the parents are out working, whatever. Amazing. And the cultural difference, you know, it's a wonderful thing to travel and explore these things and learn about all the different cultures around. And Italy has, 26 regions?
20
regions.
Yeah, 20 regions.
And, you know, and I've been to a lot of them. And the strangest thing, I haven't been to Venice yet, of all places. But I'm going to be there.
You
I got
to
get there. You know, I was very close, but not there.
You
and
have
I thought,
to.
Wow, this is just amazing. And I love the food. And I love, I'm just looking at the food here, the octopus. It's an appetizer. It's a huge appetizer.
Yes,
You know,
it's some people also they share, and it's a great addition. Also in the way that it's prepared, like already tenderized, and it's just delicious.
Well, I got to try it.
Yeah.
Chasing wild ass. Oh, it's not what you're thinking. It's all about my travel around the world. I have interspersed photos and recipes to whet your appetite and allow you to dream and discover and rediscover these faraway destinations. The title came about while we were in Koch Wild Ass Sanctuary chasing jackasses in Gujarat, India. Chasing Wild Ass is food for the soul. It's adventure, it's history, it's culture, it's culinary, and it's a lifestyle. Chasing Wild Ass will entertain you and massage your soul. It's a celebration of life. You have to live every moment as if it's your last. My world is your world. So remember, get up, get out, and travel!
I want to try the octopus because it looks like spring to me. You know, with the greenery on the top, and it looks so refreshing.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a potato.
That's a potato, yes.
Mmm. Mmm. That's very nice, too. Let me use this when you get the octopus. I can't speak. That was a huge piece. Nobody would have cut that in half.
Yeah.
It was like, it filled my whole mouth. It's unbelievable. But it is tender. And as I was saying before, the theory of people in the past, do they do it in the past or do they do it on the shore?
Normally, as soon as they catch the octopus, they used to slam it on the stone.
The rocks.
Yeah, on the rocks. Yeah, that was one way of tenderize. Not to believe the cork, because that was not tenderizing at all. And
it didn't tenderize?
No.
They just beat it because it was bad.
It was proved.
It was bad octopus. You bad boy.
Definitely. But I think in also the way that they take care of the cooking, especially poaching in the oven, that would be the best result to get a nice and tender
without having
octopus.
To do anything to it.
Yes.
Well, that's interesting because I somehow in my mind I kept thinking they're going to beat it to death or they're going to put it in the washing machine and it'll go around forever, and somehow you made it very simple. Like you don't have to go through that punishment.
Definitely.
You know, this poor little animal. You know, also the good thing is you don't see the head and the whole thing, you know, on the octopus. You're seeing only tentacles, which I think just make, well, you don't see it any of it.
Yes.
You see it's all cut up so you don't have to see it because some people can't, you know, deal with the whole
picture,
animal.
Yeah,
but this is really great. It's a great dish.
Thank you.
And how can you tell the quality of liver? How do you know it's good or bad?
Our liver is coming from one of the probably unique meat supplier in the meat packing district, the one of the remaining in the meat packing district. Sometimes we're out of it because it doesn't have it, and he said, okay, liver is coming on Monday, and so we just wait anxiously until we can get our line, our products back in line for our menu.
Right.
So it's, let's say, a lot of people knowing that the liver is not in every menu in New York. We have a quite a customer or clientele that they call for it, and they love it. So to the point that now, not only polenta, but there is also an option with a rice pilaf.
Interesting.
Yeah.
And do you buy all of your meats from this particular guy, or do you go to
Some of them. Yeah. The one that we retain, he can...
And your rabbit?
Hold up. No, the rabbit has to be another company, unfortunately. Yeah, it doesn't deal very
all
much
your special,
with that.
All your special
Correct.
Case.
Yeah.
It's interesting, you know, the purveyors and the fact that knowing, well, I guess in every industry it's the same thing. You have to know where to get it.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true.
And the best. But how can you tell a good liver from a bad liver?
Normally is presented like a very red and like a dark purple with a little membrane. It has to be nice, solid, a little bit of, let's say, bloody. Once we get it, we take this little membrane and then we try to cut it in very small pieces, like a little bigger than a julienne, but thinly sliced. And when we cook it, just very hot pan, some olive oil, and just sear momentarily. Normally you want to leave a little pink inside.
Right. And how would you tell a bad liver?
Bad liver, normally the...
No blood.
No blood to begin with. And normally the color start like getting a little more stale. So instead of...
What does that mean?
You don't see it like this beautiful red color, but it starts fading out toward the...
Grayish or...?
Yeah, grayish, like a pinkish.
Like it's dead.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So that would be already like a sign of next.
You move on.
It's a fresh liver. If you start becoming like a pinkish or green,
it's been dead for a while.
Yes.
But why would somebody sell you a bad liver anyway?
Maybe shortage.
You gotta get rid of it.
But normally we always keep an eye on getting the product as it's supposed to be.
Oh, well, that's an important thing. And I think quality is very important in anything that you buy. If you don't have quality, you know, there's a reason why people wouldn't come back if you don't have quality. But you have a lot of people returning all the time.
Definitely.
And I think that's, you know, and I'm so happy that my friend and your friend, Kaidi Tung, brought me here. And it was another experience because I wasn't aware of the restaurant. And I thought, wow. And then I said to her, you know, I should go back and feature you. And she said, what a great idea. So that's how that whole thing came about.
Well, thank you.
You never know. I mean, there's always a connection.
Yes.
You know, what do they say? 6 degrees of separation or something or other. And everybody knows everybody, and I think it's wonderful.
It's a great pleasure. Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So your wife also helps you with the business as well?
Yes.
And you've been married the whole while?
Yeah, Francesca, probably a little bit less than married to the restaurant. We've been married like 11 years.
Oh, she's a newcomer.
Yeah, yeah. And she's helping me since the lockdown, and great addition.
Of course. There's nothing like a team, you know, and also having the same vision. In any marriage, you have to have the same vision. If you don't, it's over.
Definitely.
And I know that for sure, because that happened with me.
Okay.
But anyway, what I think is so terrific is the fact that you're here in the Chelsea area, and it's a very popular area. A lot of people live here and they dine out. I don't understand how people can dine out every night, but they do in New York. And it's a wonderful thing, and it's good for the restaurant.
It is. We have an entourage of artists and neighbor galleries.
Lots of galleries in the area.
A lot of galleries. Yeah. Sometimes we host their premiering after the show.
Right.
And it's you get to know some artists and galleries itself as well. It's a pleasure. It's expanding on a daily basis.
And it's vital. I mean, it's very alive, you know, and I think that's, the neighborhood's alive.
It is.
Just terrific. I remember years ago, all the galleries were downtown. Then they moved uptown.
Yes.
Well, to Chelsea anyway. And there are just so many galleries and so many architectural wonders as well, because everywhere you look, there's another building going up, and they're creative in terms of how they, you know, more people are just moving into New York and moving into, it's just fabulous. It's just absolutely
fabulous. Also theaters. For instance, we have an Irish repertoire. We were able to host the Irish president a few years back.
How fantastic.
Before the show. And we have a Joyce Theater.
Oh, I was going to mention that.
Yeah, and it's such a pleasure, because sometimes you can fill up the early seating before theater, sometimes even after theater, and it's a joy.
And it's only like a block or two away.
Yes, yes.
Which is fantastic.
It's a walking
distance. Thank God we still have it, and also 23rd Street, you have the SVA, which also has events.
Yes.
You know, which is also convenient for you.
Yes.
You know, so you've got a great area, and you're very lucky to be here. You know, have you been in the same spot for 25 years?
23 years.
23
yes,
years.
Yes. Yes.
Same
in the
spot.
Same spot. Yeah.
The rest. You know, you are very lucky, because the restaurant business has been generally is just a very difficult business to be in. But when you have a great following, and new people coming all the time, it's the best thing going.
You have to be like a chameleon, adapting to the circumstances.
And how did you do during the COVID period? That must have been difficult.
It was March 16, and we were trying to wrap up, and I suggest, why we don't try, just do delivery tonight. And that's how we kept going, mm-hmm. without closing one day. And I think last year we closed Thanksgiving and Christmas, and we were open throughout the year.
Right, and New Year's.
Yeah, with all the exception and...
Oh, yes.
Yes.
What about New Year's?
New the Year's...
Big parties?
We close early, but we were here.
Yeah. But also what happens is that I'm thinking in terms of, the Christmas parties. There must be tons of those coming up as well.
Yes, there is a lot of inquiring, curiosity as well, to see how there is a lot of restriction, mostly on the inquiring, because they would like to disclose the full party. Sometimes it's difficult to get like a few people, cocktail only, another one hors d'oeuvre, another one dinner.
Oh yeah.
And so it's a
sit down and order your food.
Yeah, right. it's a little different than a few years back, where people knew exactly, okay, let's do this and let's go ahead. Now there is a lot of moving around and inquiry. We try to make the best with our private rooms and accommodation.
And you have two other rooms, as a matter of fact.
Yes, correct.
You've got the bar room, which is wonderful. That's where I had that wonderful late lunch. And then the other room, what do you call that room? Is that another bar?
The other room is called the Galleria.
Galleria, and it's another bar as well.
Yes, a little bar also as well. Yeah.
So you can have a private party back there?
Yes.
Or at the bar you can have another private party?
As well, and then there is another room upstairs that is called Chef's Table.
Oh.
Yeah, that's another addition. Normally we host our Chef's Table dinner. Yeah.
Right.
As and well as a private.
And what's the capacity of the restaurant?
I would say like 118 people. All together.
On a good night?
Yes.
Right.
As a seating, and plus in addition, we have this little patio outside with a heater that it was
Now, is that
built
on the street or is that in the backyard?
It's on the sidewalk.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, on the sidewalk. Yeah.
During the COVID period, everybody?
Correct, yeah. Correct.
Oh, that's terrific. Claudio, tell me about the art on the wall, because did you collect it from friends, or is it a personal collection that you bought, or where did it come from?
It's a little bit of everything. It's personal and mostly friends that I'm collecting for. For instance, the one behind me, where Madonna is showing, it's all friends, and in particular a friend of mine that lives in has a restaurant in the same block where Madonna bought a mansion. So a friend, a painter, used to work for the New Yorker. He decided to paint the full friends having in the background of
a cookout.
A cookout, a kitchen. I can find myself also where they are among the friends.
How fantastic.
Yeah,
it's a friendly picture.
Yeah, it is.
That's fantastic. Now, are any of these for sale or just?
No, it's I would say like
a gallery.
A collection, a gallery for the restaurant.
Yeah, but it's absolutely lovely. It's refreshing. When I walked in, I said, this is the room we have to shoot, because I love the paintings on the wall. They sort of tell a story, you know, and they have an elegance about them, which I think is very special. Claudio, this has been a wonderful experience, eating your wonderful food, drinking your wonderful wine. Let's toast.
Cheers.
Until the next time.
Salute.
Salute.
Grazie.
Alla italiana.
Sì, grazie.
Grazie. I'm Jon Haggins, The Taste of New York. Until next week, I hope to see you then. So long for now.